Hello, everyone. This is an interview with Adam Kokesh. He's the former host of Adam vs. the Man. He's the author of his own book, Freedom. He's appeared on many different Liberty movies as well as documentary films. And he's here to talk to us about his campaign to orderly and peacefully dissolve the United States government. Where did that, I guess, idea to become or run for president come from?
Well, it's not just the best way to get the message out, it's also the best way for humanity to move forward from statism to a free society. That's localization. And this is one of the most important ideas in my book, Freedom, which I started writing when I was in jail for civil disobedience. But to be perfectly honest about the idea of running for president, it's something that has occurred to me since I became a voluntarist when it was like, well, if you were president, what would you do? Nothing. And not only nothing, but I would actually actively dissolve the entire federal government. If you're a libertarian and you believe in free will, you believe in self-ownership, you believe in the non-aggression principle, you believe that people should be able to make decisions for themselves based on that freedom, then the idea of having any government at all is contrary to that. It is to govern, to control. That is always by force and violence when we're talking about the institution of government as we know it today. So the question really is, how do we move forward from this paradigm of statism? And I don't think it's really responsible to just say, well, we're going to wake people up and then I don't know, there's going to be some kind of collapse. And then on the other side, there will be a free society. I mean, that's just, it's not just ridiculous because it is possible that it would happen that way. But if you're doing this because you care about people, you care about making the world a better place for people, and part of your plan to create your ideal world is social collapse and blood in the streets and economic upheaval, like, I'm sorry, but that's just not very humanitarian. So I would want to see the most orderly transition possible. I would want to see it done as ethically as possible. So it sort of came from, as soon as I got this bigger political awareness, you know, the question comes up, well, if you were president, what would you do? And I would want to see the entire federal government dissolved and the power returned to the states so that the states are the highest form of government, and then the states can dissolve on the timeline that's appropriate for them, and then eventually get down to the county level, the city level, the community level. And at that point, you can replace government with the nonviolent systems that will truly render it obsolete. So, as for this, you know, particular campaign, the you know, idea has been developing for me over, I guess, the last 5 or 6 years of my full-time activism. And what motivates me, you know, more than anything is being a peace activist. And this came from my experience in Fallujah, in Iraq, in 2004 with the Marine Corps. And, you know, it's funny because they teach you about Major General Smedley Butler in Marine Corps boot camp, but they don't tell you that when he got out of the military, he wrote a book called War is a Racket, in which he describes himself as a high-class muscle man for big business. And so when I got out of the Marines, I was a real angry dude. I was like, you know, I got lied to. I got taken advantage of. I saw my buddies die because we were lied to. And I that really, you know, that really, oh, there's something about that that you really can't shake. And when it's affected me, you know, personally, psychologically, dealing with PTSD, there was a process of me realizing that it's not enough to be against one war or bad wars or wars that don't fit the Christian just war theory model. You have to be against all forms of violence. You know, you have to be against, well, first, militarism. And when you realize, you know, militaries make us less safe, having a government makes us less safe. This is why the founders of this country were at least against the principle or the idea of a standing army entirely. So, you know, wanting to see a world of peace, you know, if you don't have peace, you don't have freedom. Freedom is what you have when no one is forcing their will on you in any way. If you're being threatened, if you have violence being committed against you, you're not free. And yeah, I know you can say, well, we have a hypothetically free ideal society. Well, you know, the moment someone gets punched in the face, it's not free for them. And I think it's really important to recognize that connection between violence and freedom. And if you get that, then you want to really look at the root causes of violence. And it's that not just, our own psychological deficiencies as human beings that tempt us to violence, our inability to meet our needs peacefully, but, the communication behind how we talk to each other, all of those things. And then when you go, well, okay, I want freedom, I want peace, what's the biggest source of violence in the world? Well, duh, 90% of the violence committed in the world today is done in the name of governments. And if you, got rid of governments, you'd get rid of 90% of the rest of the violence, because that's caused indirectly by government in terms of the drug war and, I would call it the war on poverty, but more generally, the government's war on prosperity, the government's war on free trade, the government's war on productivity. So then you have to look at how do we get out of this system that so many people are dependent upon without pulling the rug out from underneath anyone. And that's where, to me, over the past few years of my activism, I've been developing this idea of localization. I should say, the past few years before writing my book, when I was in jail a couple of years ago, and the idea is that we can take governments apart from the top down. And, I think patriotism is generally a dangerous idea. You can say love of country, but if country is defined by government, by arbitrary lines drawn on a map by politicians and circumstance of history, you're allowing your love to be defined by violent people, by this kind of arbitrariness. So if patriotism is love of, your people, love of an area, that's fine, that's one thing. I would describe myself as a patriot of the world. But there is one thing about our heritage as Americans that I am, in a sense, proud of. And I use the word, proud very carefully, because pride is a sin. But I do celebrate the fact that the American Revolution was a major step forward for humanity, that it was, at least psychologically, a major leap in terms of how we think of natural rights, how we think of human rights, and how we think of freedom. And I'm very excited to see that here in America today, we have such a huge enthusiasm for secession and a great culture of libertarianism in general. And because of our federal structure of our government, where we have very clearly well understood delineations between federal government and the state governments and county governments and city governments, we are in a position now to lead the world forward once again, going from the most violent government on earth to the least. And that's how we move forward in freedom, is we eliminate that central control, we eliminate militaries, we eliminate the violence, we turn to what are much more righteous and more effective means of defending ourselves, that is a well-armed population who refuses to be governed by anyone. And we can really show the way forward for humanity if we're able to make this turn. And I'd like to think that my own life, my own journey, is a bit of a microcosm of what I'm trying to invite America to join me in. And having gone from, a warrior, going from a Marine to a peace activist, to a healer, to someone who wants to, take this experience that I've gone through and share it with others. And if I can go from, being willing to kill for politicians to now doing everything I can to stand up to government, being willing to go to jail and commit civil disobedience, when called for, at least in my own strategy. And I got to say, out of true humility, that I've made every mistake possible in the activist playbook, and going to jail should not be the objective of any activism, but it is one tool, and I think it was, at least in the past, a measure of my commitment to this cause. So now I'm in the exploratory phase. We're hoping to build this campaign organization over the next 6 months or so and switch over into active campaign mode in May, assuming that everything keeps going according to plan and the support keeps building. So it's not just about waking people up, although that is essential. It's really about providing a transition to move forward a lot more rapidly than would happen otherwise in order to eliminate as much violence as possible. Every day less that the state exists is a day less of violence, of the military, of war, of the police state, of the exploitation of government in general, of the theft that is taxation. And I don't think that, I do believe that everybody is capable of getting this message. Everybody that is an independent human consciousness capable of rational thought can understand the concept of self-ownership. but we're gonna be able to make change faster if we propose immediate practical solutions that serve everyone and make it easy for them. You know, it's one thing to say, you know, that we can wake everyone up, and it's another to actually say, well, how do we move forward as fast as possible while that's happening? So, you know, you can wake someone up too, and if they're stuck in the matrix, they might, you know, get out of the matrix psychologically and say, okay, I don't buy into it, but they got a 9-to-5, they got a house payment, they got car payments, they got medical bills, they're taking care of a family. You can't just say, all right, now you should go totally agorist and opt out of the system and only use Bitcoin and barter. Like, that's just not realistic for most people. So we should be actively working to make it as easy as possible to make that transition. And if I can get up and say, hey, I'll come up with a plan for dismantling the federal government, for localizing it down to the states, well, hey, now it's that much easier for people. All you have to do is come out and vote, and those of us who are willing to put in the work on that level will take care of the mechanics of localizing government.
Right. Right. Well, I think that's perfect. And I think to your point, that's really the best way to go about it is people need that systematic kind of orderly plan to really buy into, to have someone lead the charge and really, you know, dissolve the government as we know it and empower the people. So I think that's a tremendous methodology. And so I wanted to ask, you know, on that vein, since your campaign's all about orderly and peacefully dismantling the government in very tangible and practical and, as you mentioned, systematic ways, so that people can see the results, as opposed to, you know, having to churn through potentially, you know, violence and upheaval and, you know, all these other things that generally come with a revolution. How has your work with the Libertarian Party thus far kind of given you either insights or helped shape your thoughts on how we can systematically dissolve government?
Well, if anything, the Libertarian Party, I think, is an incredible tool and an incredible mechanism of proposing these ideas in a practical way. I mean, I think it doesn't get any better than that if what you want to bring about is this kind of political change. I think that the Libertarian Party base is very much in line with what I'm talking about, and from, you know, my experience traveling around the country. We just did a national tour, 60 stops in 2 months, the For the Love of Freedom tour, which was the exploratory tour for this campaign. There's great enthusiasm for these ideas, and people really want to see this. I think in many ways we've failed as a party, as a movement, to really put forth practical policy propositions that are truly in line with this message and these values. And I think Gary Johnson, I got to say, I love Gary Johnson. I consider him a friend. He was my governor in New Mexico when he was, you know, a man of incredible integrity. But I think a lot of people who are real libertarians, because he's one of those who's more a political libertarian or a libertarian in name only, because he doesn't embrace the core principle of the Libertarian Party, which is awesome to see that the party has made the party of principle mean something, putting the non-aggression principle front and center in the platform. But he's a socially liberal, fiscally conservative. And the problem with that is that it doesn't get this message out. It's not really in line with these values to say, well, you know, we believe you own yourself, except we're still going to run the government and I'm still going to be president. And it's like, no, the only libertarian answer to what would you do if president is dissolve the federal government and resign, you know? And in my case for this plan, it's even much more immediate than that. So if I may jump ahead a little bit, the platform is to go into the White House, sign one executive order that would be written out well in advance with a relatively detailed plan for how we dissolve the federal government, agency by agency, what things need to be spun off, what need to be transitioned to the states, what can just be eliminated, what property needs to be dealt with in what manner to responsibly sell it off or whatever the case may be in that particular incident or in that particular instance with whatever physical property we're talking about, and would assign it would mean immediately declaring the federal government to be of no authority whatsoever, and I would be with this executive order resigning from the presidency to become the custodian of the federal government, not the president of the United States. And this is such
Okay.
an important distinction because it's saying, no, immediately we are switching from an unethical system to an to at least an ethical handling of this institution. So we would also appoint custodians for each federal agency. I would not be appointing a Secretary of Defense. It would be a custodian of the Department of Defense. And this executive order would lay out very specific guidelines for what they would have to carry out in the dismantling of the Defense Department, which of course really should be more accurately referred to by one of its other titles, the War Department. And that, you know, we have a pretty specific plan. So the, you know, there's going to be a lot of leeway. There's going to be a lot of things that, you know, those custodians of each department are going to have to figure out. But the only power that I would retain as custodian of the federal government would be to replace department heads if necessary during that process. Other than that, this is a very clear mandate from the beginning that would be, you know, from the American people through the election process, that we would be able to take over the federal government as custodians for the purpose of dismantling it in this preordained, responsible manner.
Have you started to outline, as part of your platform, some of the different types of strategies you're going to have for each one of those departments? Have you, or do you have anything to kind of share on that in terms of, you know, what are you going to do with the quote unquote Department of Defense or the War Department, right? I mean, what is like that one may be a good one to kind of start with. What specifically would you do to provide people the safety that they're looking for, right? That's obviously the goal, I think, of all the individuals want. And obviously the government's absconded with that mission statement. But I mean, how would you fill that gap? Because a lot of people are going to be like, you know, how are we going to protect ourselves during this transition period from other foreign enemies, but also, you know, maybe police or things like that?
That's a great question, but it's really important to understand it. And so I'll get to the details with the Department of Defense, and then we can get into all the other agencies, because that really is the big one. But before I get into the specifics, I really need to reframe this for people, because this is so important that we understand that having a government makes us less safe. And it's important to understand first that wars are not fought between countries. This is one of the great myths of statism. Wars are conducted by governments looking to expand the scope of their protection rackets. It is not something that happens between countries. And if you tell your government, please govern me, please tax me, please rule over me, and subject me to your monopoly defense services, it sends a very clear message to any other government around the world. Oh, these are people who like to be slaves. Now, if we take over that territory, we can enslave them, we can rule them. So the better answer for national defense is to have a well-armed population who refuses to be governed by anyone. So we don't need a replacement. It's sort of like, you have to understand that a military is a cancer on safety. So if I say, hey, let's get rid of this cancer because it's a threat to our health, let's get rid of the military because it's a threat to our safety, you wouldn't say, well, gee, I don't know, what are you going to replace that cancer with? That sounds scary, not having cancer? Wow, I'm so used to having cancer. I don't know if I would feel safe without cancer. Can we have like... Can we have some other kind of cancer? Can we have a smaller cancer? Can we have a more local cancer? And it's like, no, no, no. You want to be healthy? No cancer. No cancer at all. You know, you want to be safe. No government, no military, no protection racket at all is going to make you much safer. So in terms of having a well-armed population, so getting back to the you know, the practicalities of this, If you want to have a true national defense, and again, it shouldn't be about national defense. It should be about individual defense, family defense, community defense. It should be about reforming the way this population thinks about being governed at all, so that nobody ever wants to rule us or govern us in any way ever again. That's the ultimate defense. So in that vein, I think when you dismantle the Department of Defense, I'd like to see... You know, and this is where you have, of all the federal agencies, this is probably the trickiest, if not the trickiest, or most complex in terms of how we dismantle it. And you know, you have to first bring all the troops home from abroad. You have to, you know, have an orderly process of turning over the facilities and the you know, and the equipment at all of these facilities. I think the appropriate thing to do would be turn it over to their those former host nations of those embassies. And as a general principle, a bigger challenge is the nuclear arsenal, right? Well, no more nuclear weapons. I mean, this is the only government that has ever dropped them on actual people. It should be the last one that should be ever trusted with nuclear weapons in the first place. And if you really do the history in World War II, even by the you know, statist military mentality, neither of the nuclear bombs being dropped was necessary in you know, by any honest analysis. And even most military historians who still buy into that military paradigm understand that the second one wasn't necessary. So it is really sick that we allow these things to exist in the first place. So weapons that aren't capable of being used for a genuine defensive purpose really simply need to be destroyed or disabled or dismantled or recycled in some way. So when it comes to, like, you know, jets, airplanes, maybe there's some civilian use for them. Maybe they can be auctioned off. You know, maybe tanks can be melted down and recycled. Maybe they can be sold for scrap metal. If there's a huge pile of M16s, I have no problem with those being handed over to civilians or to the states to be distributed to civilians. For ammunition for small arms, same thing. I think that would be appropriate to be turned over to legitimate, organic, local militia forces. I think a lot of those resources can go to creating that well-armed population in a responsible manner. And, you know, so the biggest things can be simply, you know, liquidated. And what I'd like to see for that, there are a lot of debts that this country should be paying off. And I'm not talking about debts to national banks or central banks or foreign governments or military contractors, but legitimate debts to people who have been harmed by this government. I think reparations to a lot of people who have been hurt by American military intervention abroad. I think a lot of those resources should go to those purposes. Which gets me to another related agency, which is the Department of Veterans Affairs. There's no reason the Department of Veterans Affairs should be eliminated simply because the federal government is eliminated. It simply needs to be spun off as an independent nonprofit agency that, you know, is not funded by taxation. So maybe it gets an endowment from all of this stuff that's being sold off from the military. And, you know, instead of being governed by, you know, some presidential appointee, it can be turned over to veterans themselves, who would have each a single voting share in policy for the Department of Veterans Affairs, and it would then have more than enough resources to take care of people. And I think this could be potentially a much bigger turning point for the paradigm of, you know, hatred and control and violence, and more towards peace, love, freedom, cooperation, and harmony. That if the Department of Veterans Affairs had, you know, a surplus of resources, you know, if the Department of Defense money from liquidation is being able to put to good use, that it could be a hugely charitable organization that could provide health care for not just veterans, but all victims of statism. And that really includes everybody, even who's not able to afford medical care simply because they've been, you know, one way or another taxed or regulated or squeezed out of the market. And I think that could be an incredible force for good in this country.
And actually, that brings up another great point about, I think, one of the other major concerns, you know, kind of the average American would have, is how would you deal with obligations that the government's kind of created over time? Obviously, like you mentioned, Veterans Affairs, I think that's a great methodology to spin it off, become a charity, make, you know, veteran stakeholders take some of the selling of assets that the government currently has absconded with, and fund that as a seed fund, right, to kind of get it rolling. What would you do with, like, Social Security? So how would you have a similar tactic there, or how would you deal with some of the obligations that we've kind of committed to as an entity that now you're dissolving, and those people, you know, have expectations of those kind of obligations?
Well, first, I'd be very careful about the language of we here. We are not the government in this country, not by a long shot. All the studies that show how corrupt our government is and how irrelevant our voices are in voting really back that up. So I just want to caution you there, Scott. You know, hey, got to be careful when you say we here.
I'm speaking as the average voter.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And so... No, that's and your question is entirely valid and certainly an important one. What do you do with the Social Security system? And if I may step back, and I promise I'll come back to that. I'm not trying to avoid it because, and I will say, like, I've been challenged with what about this, what about that? And while there are, you know, certain things that might be difficult to figure out, overall the principles are very easy to apply to these situations, and there's not going to be a perfect answer, but there's going to be an answer that's way more practical than continuing to suffer under the yoke of the federal government. So for welfare in general, what I'd like to see happen is to have it be transitioned or returned to the states. It's possible with Social Security, if there are enough federal assets, if we can make it work financially, that there would be a way to fund it for a limited time, to phase it out, to have it continue. But I got to step back first with the financial problem here with the monetary system. And the question is, what is the state of the U.S. dollar at the point at which the American people decide we don't need a federal government anymore? Now, I can't say that I live a, you know, perfectly ethical life in the sense that, you know, I still use the dollar as my primary currency as opposed to Bitcoin and metals and barter. And so, I'm in a sense, you know, I'm feeding into that, and I really do understand that there are problems with that, but I conduct as much of my business as possible in Bitcoin. I do as much of my business in barter as I can. I don't have any savings that are enumerated in dollars in any way. My savings are the land I'm sitting on right here. I have a little pile of silver, and I have a little stash of Bitcoin. But I imagine that if we got to the point where 50% of the American population or a critical mass of voters stood up and was able to say, okay, I'll vote, let's abolish the federal government, you'd already have a major chunk checked out of the dollar system. And when we went on this platform in November and take office in January, we've got a three-month period in which I imagine a lot of people are going to be paying attention to this stuff, and I don't think the dollar is even going to be a viable currency at that point. So if the dollar doesn't exist and none of these systems really exist this way, it's very difficult to say, you know, how we would handle it specifically when we don't know what the state of the economy is going to be and what the state of the monetary system is going to be. We shouldn't be afraid of a dollar collapse because Bitcoin is already a vibrant and practical enough system that if the dollar were to collapse tomorrow, yes, we'd have some economic upheaval, but relatively quickly we would be able to adjust and switch over to Bitcoin and get back to, you know, at least a normal, well, I wouldn't say normal, a much healthier, more vibrant economic reality if that were to happen. So, With Social Security, if there's a way to give it a sort of endowment or a trust and create it, make it into a charity and spin it off and phase it out, I would want to explore that. I would hope that something like that would be practical. At very least, what we can do is transition it to the state. So if state governments are using their own currencies at that point, or if state governments are using Bitcoin or some other cryptocurrency or some other gold-backed currency or some other free market currency, whatever the case may be, then I think it would be really the most practical answer, the sort of, you know, backup plan, if you will, even that states would manage those systems, and it would be part of the responsibility of my transition team, of whoever is the custodian of those various welfare departments, to at least handle the databases and the administration of those services, you know, transition them in a responsible way back to the states. Right. I shouldn't say back to the states. It's not going back to the states, but down to the states.
Down to the states. Right. Yeah, exactly. And then actually that begs another good question, because I think that's kind of a good overview of the strategy of how you would handle some of these more challenging departments, which I think is great.
Right, hold on. If I may interrupt for a second, Scott, just to point out, most agencies don't even bring these challenges. I mean, we got Defense Department is a challenge. We've got, you know, wealth, everything that's under welfare is a challenge. Everything else that's in, you know, security or, you know, false security, FBI, CIA, NSA, things like that. Yeah, those are a bit of a challenge. But most federal agencies, IRS gone, EPA gone, no more daylight savings time. Yes, it's gone. Like we get to do our best that we can now to honor treaties with Native American tribes. All of these amazing things, like all of the regulatory agencies, all of the burdens, all of the taxation, gone, gone, gone. They just don't exist anymore. And it's a really relatively easy thing to deal with those agencies. Like Department of Education doesn't run a single school, doesn't educate a single child. What do you do with it? Give everybody, well, I don't think you even need to give them 2 weeks notice. They get 3 months notice. We win this election in November, they have till January to pack their stuff and go home. And that's really all they deserve at that point. For the IRS, like, what are we going to do with the IRS? Well, if we decide to be nice and not cut people's hands off for being thieves, we're not going to. That's a joke. What do we, and then the physical facilities that those agencies possess, the buildings, the desks, the furniture, stuff like that, maybe those all get rolled up into the Defense Department. Maybe they get rolled into some other agency that is going to be around longer in order to deal with those physical properties with a specific objective of creating an endowment for, a legitimate charitable purpose.
That's exactly it, right? I mean, most of these things obviously aren't necessary, and obviously they're a huge burden, and so they just get cut from the beginning. And I think that's a perfect strategy. And yeah, and I think that's why defense was so important, and some of these quasi welfare programs or Social Security type programs are kind of the key topical ones. And I think you have a good strategy behind that. And I think that's a good way to encapsulate what most of the strategy is, right? So it's going to be for these specific big ones where there may be some legitimate purpose afterwards that needs to be pushed into the free market. We understand your strategy there. For the ones that have absolutely no purpose and just completely overhead or just pure violence, those will get cut immediately. And that's perfect. So the one thing I did, you do talk about states a lot, and I think that's an interesting topic too. I wanted you to maybe kind of elaborate a little bit more on how you see the role of individual states after the federal government is gone, and what your thoughts are there.
Well, it would definitely be temporary, whatever it is. And I think it's important in the transition, in order to bring more people on board, that we allow them to not fully abandon their concept of what government is, that we allow them to have an orderly transition. So what would the role of the states be? It would be to, go get back to a point of stasis, if you will, of things being reliable at that level. But in some states, people are going to be like, well, we eliminated the federal government for these reasons, time to eliminate the state government along the same lines as soon as possible. But I don't want to have any, like, the majority, it's fundamentally unethical to have a democracy where you hold an election, and because some group of people said they want this to happen, you now force the results on everybody regardless of what they had to say. So if there really is a consensus in a state that the state government, needs to continue to exist for some period of time, let that be determined by the people of that state. Although clearly my objective is to create a more ethical society and to provide a mechanism by which we can achieve that in a practical manner. So I don't claim any authority as a presidential candidate or someone who would be president for a day in order to dissolve the federal government or initiate that process more accurately. I wouldn't pretend to have any authority over the states. I wouldn't pretend to have any say in that. My say would be simply to be able to vocalize, like, hey, even at the state level, that's still unethical for you to have a state level democracy where you're forcing something on somebody against their will just because other people said they wanted it. So I would hope that every state is able to transition for the same reasons, as rapidly as possible, as practically as possible, as orderly as possible, down to the county level. In some states that won't even be necessary. I mean, you look at some states with very low population or very low geography, Vermont, North Dakota, states like that. maybe they get to go immediately to, well, now we just have, you know, county sheriff organizations and bam, that's it for government. And we're able to transition completely to nonviolent systems at the state level. In a lot of states that are bigger, I mean, you look at like Florida, New York, California, obviously, where, you know, you have huge populations, major city centers. You're going to have a transition first to counties before you're able to really get away from government entirely.
Right. Right. And that makes perfect sense. Yeah. And that follows along with obviously the orderly fashion, right? And peacefully giving people time to kind of absorb what's going on. And, you know, now that newfound freedom that they're getting because the federal government's not on their back at the state level, I think that's going to have amazing impacts at the state level in terms of what they do and, you know, how they decide to transition out of the violence apparatus, right, that they have today. So what, I guess along those lines, what is kind of your main methodology of, you know, kind of laid out a strategy, you have a platform, you've been thinking about this for a long time. What is your strategy for getting people to buy into this? I mean, obviously there's, you know, the kind of, the more esoteric discussion, which I don't think is super important, you know, that anarchists may have about, well, why are you seeking, you know, to become president to dissolve the government? But I think,
well, it's like, I'm seeking to become not president. You know, I kind of got to correct right. You a little bit in your introduction. we refer to this as the Kokesh for not president campaign, not Kokesh for president, not Kokesh 2020, not Freedom 2020. Also, I don't mind people calling it Freedom 2020. That's fine. But okay. And I'm also happy to acknowledge that I know this sounds crazy, but we might not win in 2020. It might be that 4 years from now, people still want to violently control each other, that we haven't had this beautiful paradigm shift. And so it really is about, you know, waking people up until we get to the critical mass that we can get the national consensus to do this. And I will continue to run until the federal government ceases to exist one way or another. And I cannot promise that it's going to happen this way. I need to throw this out there, too, that I cannot promise that somebody can even win on this platform. It might not be possible. It might be that a collapse is inevitable. It might be that, you know, we get global government before we come to a point of collapse, although I think that's very unlikely. I think what's more likely is that we have a widespread secession movement and we see states breaking off from the federal government one at a time, which would be beautiful. I would be happy, so happy to see that. And I think there's actually a global trend already towards localization. You know, we see it in Europe. We see it in secession movements all throughout the United States. After Brexit, there's Texit. And I just saw a really clever thing on Facebook. Someone sent a picture where they created a hashtag for every state secession movement. So, like, I wish I could remember more of them, but like, Ohio was like, Obio, Florida exit, you know, New Hampshire is, I don't know. There's just so many clever names for all of these. I should have remembered all of them. Colorado as in, go away. But you know, we actually see serious movements for 51st states in Jefferson, the state of Jefferson, which would be Northern California and Southern Oregon. There's a similar movement in Colorado. Vermont and New Hampshire both have long-standing secession movements. You know, there's Hawaii, Alaska, you know, movements of Native American reservations seeking greater autonomy. I think this is part of the realization of the era of the internet, that people realize that central control is inferior to local control. But eventually they're going to realize that human beings should not be violently controlling each other under any circumstances except in actual immediate, you know, violent self-defense.
Defense, yeah, exactly. No, that makes perfect sense. Exactly. So what is so? We didn't come up with a good one for Montana. There's actually a project in Montana that's been around off and on, but it's I actually just kind of started talking to the people running it. But there's a Free Montana project, and we're gonna come up with a good slogan for them. But anyway, that's a good one.
Gontana.
God, yeah, there you go. I like that. That's perfect. Anyway, so I guess to that point, you're speaking to the voters at this point. Kind of framing the question here is that you're speaking to voters that may not have, been fully aware of these concepts in the past. I guess how are you going to attract voters outside of kind of the libertarian, objectivist, anarcho-capitalist kind of world and get them on board? I guess what's your core message to people who are new to these concepts and relatively new to this philosophy and this strategy?
Well, first, the philosophy really is of universal appeal. If you're an independent human consciousness with a free will, you own yourself and you want to have your will respected. This is, and if I can't convince you of that, if I can't convince you that you're a free, beautiful, independent human being who deserves to be free and not governed and not subjected to violence at the hands of anyone, well, then fine. Okay, so you're a statist, you're a conservative statist, you're a liberal statist, you live in a liberal state, you live in a conservative state. Would you rather be governed locally, where your voice and your vote have a chance of mattering, or would you rather be governed by Washington, D.C., someone in a far-off capital who is going to be corrupt by special interests? It's very simple. What do you want? If you believe in a conservative form of government, if you believe in a moderate form of government, if you believe in a liberal form of government, you're going to be much better off with government localized rather than centralized.
Yeah, exactly. No, I think that, and that's a perfect message, right? And I think more people, I think once they realize that, that the ability to actually more directly control the things that they see as, outside their immediate control, because a lot of people I've talked to that are kind of still statists, so to speak, right? They're like, well, someone needs to worry about the roads and worry about this and worry about, you know what I mean? It's like even if they agree with that philosophy of yes, I want control and yes, I want to control myself and my life, they're like, well, there's a bunch of esoteric stuff that I don't really care about and someone else can worry about it, etc. And so I think there's this gap too, is obviously empowering the individual, which I think is one of the best messages we can ever preach. But is also, how do you convince them that the free market is the right place to put these things that they, don't want to worry about on their daily life? Like roads are definitely the perfect example. I was talking to this very progressive person, executive type, and they're like, I work all day long. I don't have time to figure out where these roads are going. That's why I want government, right? Obviously, anyway, so what's your strategy behind trying to get people to relinquish that kind of expectation that they can throw that burden to someone else or that the free market is the right place to put that, so to speak?
Well, when someone's best objection is, "Well, I don't have time to figure that out," I would say, "Well, do you use a cell phone? Do you use a computer? Did you figure out how the internet works? Or did you pay someone to do that? Did you trust that someone else is going to engineer a computer that's going to work and a cell phone that's not going to explode, of course, unless it's a Note 7? Are you confident that you can delegate tasks peacefully?" And I'll reference it's a video I'm actually about to post today from my friend Crystal Buckner in Seattle, who was I get to take credit for converting her from being a Bernie Sanders supporter to being a libertarian, primarily with my video that was "Every Bernie Sanders Supporter Needs to Hear This." And she spoke at our tour event in Seattle, and I pointed out I'm a fan of referencing this from my own personal experience. My start in activism was with the Iraq Veterans Against the War, and that there it was revealed once Obama got traction in the Democratic primary in 2008 that the anti-war movement wasn't really an anti-war movement as much as it was an ideologically based leftist anti-Bush movement. And the deal they made with Obama, without the unstated deal, was, "Oh, well, you're going to give me health care, you're going to give me free health care." And of course we know that didn't even work out at all. That didn't pan out. But "Oh, you're going to give me free health care, huh? Okay, well, in that case, I guess it's okay if you keep killing brown people on the other side of the planet." And so
Yeah.
the way that
Yeah, don't mean the
Crystal
last sentence is just so ironically stupid. I mean, oh yeah,
and
sorry.
like someone comes to you and says, "Okay, I'm going to give you health care, but you have to let me murder innocent people still." You really trust that person to keep their promise? Like, how insane is that? But then Crystal, I gotta hand it to her for putting it in so much more beautiful, positive terms. When it's, well, like, who's gonna pay for roads? Who's gonna pay for health care for poor people? Who's gonna pay for welfare? Who's gonna pay to take care of poor people? Because those are important social functions. And she said, look, if you care so much about those things that you're willing to let the people providing them murder innocent people and steal half of your income from you, because that's what it is, the average American works for government half the year, then you'll pay for them. And if you have twice as much economic resources available to you because you're not being taxed to support that violence anymore, you will be more than capable of paying for them. And it doesn't mean that you as an individual have to figure out where the roads go. It means that you get to direct those resources non-violently through your decisions as a consumer. And you get to direct them to people who are peacefully appealing to you, saying, hey, we can provide these services better and more efficiently than anyone else. So yeah, they're hypothetically, if it might be slightly more work instead of having to pay your taxes and read the news about all the violence of the government every day. Now, once or twice a year, you have to decide which charities to donate to. You have to decide which car companies or gas companies are going to be your the ones that you pay for your resources that are going to go for. Then those are the ones that are going to have an interest in building the roads. You know, Walter Block, brilliant academic, professor at Loyola, wrote a 500-page book about who would build the roads in a free society. And I was like, well, the first 60 pages of it were awesome. That was as far as I needed to get into it. Because, you know, in a bigger sense, it really doesn't matter. Nonviolent relations will always result in more human happiness than violent coercive relations. So the other thing about who will build the roads, we're not gonna need roads where we're going, baby. You know, when it comes to the technology that we have that is just around the corner, that is really only being kept from us because of government, the idea of who will build the roads is like saying, well, you know, without government, who's gonna support the horse and buggy manufacturers? Who's gonna clean the horse crap off the streets? It really is regressive even to say, well, when we get rid of government and we establish a nonviolent society, who's gonna build the roads? Like, we're gonna have flying cars. At least we're gonna have all self-driving cars by then. We're gonna have way more efficient ways of paving flat surfaces than what we have today. I mean, the technology is already available. You know, there was the whole solar roads phenomenon that we saw as an internet sensation, I think, a couple of years ago. You know, and that's just one possibility. But you know, there's so many other ways that we see humanity on the brink of much better paradigms of taking care of each other, of transportation, of infrastructure, that when we get government out of the way, we'll be able to much more fully realize.
People actually like help you support your campaign. I know you've said a number of times in the past that, you know, this is kind of like, it's a grassroots campaign, obviously, that you're looking for people to be involved. You're looking for people to help share ideas, spread the message, of course. But how can people get involved? I mean, what's the best way for them to get involved in the campaign and help you, really, and help themselves by extension?
That's awesome. I really appreciate that question, because right now, as we're working behind the scenes to build the organization, we're building state by state, district by district. So if you want to help out and sign up that way, I would greatly appreciate it. If you go to the forums at thefreedomline.com, that's my website, thefreedomline.com. You can go to the forums, sign up under your state, put down your contact information, and when we get to the point where we're starting to actively organize at the state level, we'll be in touch. We'll have a state coordinator who will be in touch with you. We'll have regional coordinators. We're already signing people up for a lot of these positions. So if you want to sign up, you know, you're getting in line here. And if you want to donate, of course, you can donate now, but not to the presidential campaign, only to the my 501c3 nonprofit, the Freedom Fund. And none of those funds will be used illegally, in the sense that none of them will go to campaign activities, but they will go towards spreading the message, to getting the book out for free. You know, right now I get requests every day from high school students, college students, especially. I'm really excited about being able to support them. People who want, you know, 10 books for their friends, 40 books for a class, you know, or a couple hundred books to pass out at their school. And so really it's about arming activists with this, which is the book that I wrote to be the most effective tool for waking people up to this paradigm. So it really is critical to help spread the word, help spread the message. Share my videos, share other videos that you think wake people up. Courageously go forth and share this message with people. And I hope that at least for my small part of it now, I can provide you with a way of communicating not just the message itself as a philosophical abstract concept, but an immediate practical way for how we move forward from the status paradigm. So sign up on the website, sign up to my email list, you can donate to my nonprofit, I would greatly appreciate that, and you can help spread the message in all the wonderful ways that you know you can reach people around you. And if you haven't talked to everyone in your family yet, your immediate family at least, ask them to consider this message, why it's important to you that we move humanity towards a more ethical society. You know, I encourage you to at least start with them. Start with the people who are closest to you. Tell them, hey, this is something I care about. This is something important to me. This is something I'd like you to consider. And if not, if I can't get you on board with the message, then I hope I could get you on board at least with the concept of localizing government. And that would be, that provides a very important bridge that I think is better than, you know, some contradictory minarchist philosophy to say, look, here's how we move forward to a better world, whether or not you want to think on that level at all. I would just remind everyone two things: be positive and be patient. It took me 10 years. 10 freaking years. Yeah, I'm dense, you know. I was in the Marine Corps. I like to learn the hard way, right? And 10 years from when in high school I first identified as a libertarian, socially conservative, socially awkward. No, I'm sorry, socially liberal, fiscally conservative, and then to understanding freedom as an ethical concept. It took me 10 years. So for some people it's going to take that long, and some people are going to need a lot of time to really absorb this message fully, and that's okay. So be positive, be patient. If they're asking questions, don't be offended by that. You have to stay patient with them. They're asking because they're engaging. They want to figure this out. Sometimes those questions sound like smart-ass questions, but most of the time they're not. These are questions from people who genuinely, you know, care about freedom and want to understand this message. And so if you can stay positive and stay patient, then you really can't go wrong in how you wake people up. And if you hit a block and say, well, I don't know the answer to that, you know, who's going to do this? How does this work? Hey, the answers are right here in Freedom. I got it boiled down to 100 pages, a free audiobook, free book in every digital format possible. I sell it as cheap as I can get away with on my website. So that is there as a free resource for you to help spread the message and wake people up. And ultimately, that's the single most important thing to moving humanity forward, is changing the paradigm to raise the standard of ethics in society.